All of the music in this presentation was paid for and downloaded legally from the iTunes Music Store.
Except some of this music was created by Keith.
Hello, everybody. This is Keith Petrower, and thank you so much for tuning in to my Sonic Arts podcast about...
Bob Donnelly and music law.
Okay, well, this is going to be a detailed presentation about music law. We're going to take a look at what music lawyers do, how a Sonic Arts student could become a music lawyer, and we're going to hear from Bob Donnelly, who I was privileged to speak with. Mr. Donnelly is one of the most prominent music lawyers in the world, and he revolutionized the legal profession by being one of the first intellectual property lawyers to specialize in music specifically. So let's start out with a quote from Mr. Donnelly.
I believe that the music business is in the middle of a giant cataclysm. I think that the music industry will change more in the next 2 years than it has changed in the last 30. Bob Donnelly, music attorney.
Okay, well, maybe I made that a little more dramatic than I needed to be. That actually wasn't Mr. Donnelly speaking, but that was a quote of his. And I don't think anyone could disagree that the music industry is changing a lot, really fast, which illustrates how Sonic Arts students, first of all, should have at least some understanding of the laws that allow us to make money from music. And second of all, you know, it shows that there is an opportunity for students who understand all of this new technology to be the ones who are the trailblazers making new laws for internet sales, for digital sales, and, you know, whatever becomes the new model for the music business in the future. But I'm getting a little ahead of myself here. Let's first ask ourselves this question.
Contracts, licenses, iTunes, Napster. What is music law?
What does it mean?
Well, what is music law? Difficult question to answer, but luckily, there's another lawyer who helped me with this presentation. Let me introduce him to you.
Mark Quayle, music lawyer, tell us what it is.
I'll take it that we all agree that music has a monetary value, as we pay money to hear music, whether it be through the purchase of CDs or the payment of concert tickets. The business models that have developed over the last century, including the sheet music business, the record business, and the practice of licensing music to film and television productions, are all based on this acceptance of music's monetary value. The term music publishing causes much of the confusion about what these rights refer to. The term has its origins in the days over 100 years ago when sheet music was the dominant form of music distribution. Music sheets were printed and published in the same manner that books were. In the music world today, sheet music is no longer the main source of income for songwriters, but the term still defines the business of making money from songs. Don't confuse music publishing royalties with record royalties. The person who performs the song gets royalties from the sale of records. The person who wrote the song gets publishing royalties. The two types of royalties are separate because the copyright in the record and the copyright in the song are two different things. Let's look at an example. Bob Dylan wrote the song All Along the Watchtower. He also recorded it. In that version, Bob Dylan will get the record royalties as being the performing artist on that record, and he'll also get the music publishing royalties as being the songwriter of that song.
Say the Joker to the thief. There's too much confusion. I can't get no relief. Businessmen, they drink my wine. Plowmen dig my earth. None of them along the line know what any of it is worth.
Now, A year after Bob released his version, Jimi Hendrix recorded the same song.
Must be some kind of way out of here. Say the Joker to the thief. There's too much confusion. I can't get no relief.
Jimi Hendrix will get the record royalties because he was the performer on that record. Bob Dylan will not see any record royalties from that performance. However, Jimi Hendrix will not see any of the music publishing royalties as Bob Dylan wrote the song. Bob Dylan will collect all the publishing royalties derived from the sale of the Jimi Hendrix recording. There were several participants in the creation of music, songwriters, recording and performing artists, studio producers, and engineers among them. The job of the music publisher is to protect the interests of the songs and the songwriter, ensuring the longest, most profitable life for the musical work. Unless the song is in the public's ears, it will be forgotten. However, context is an important component in ensuring a long life for the musical work. For example, if a song that has already had some success is placed in a commercial in a context that becomes irritating to the public, the listener will begin to associate that unpleasantness with the song, even when it is heard apart from the offending commercial.
Hey, it's Keith again. Here's a fun game. Can you guess which companies paid tens of thousands, or in some cases, millions of dollars for the rights to these songs?
Do you?
The rights for this song sold for $8 million. One of my personal favorite bands. This next one, you'll probably think of the product before you think of the band. In this Iggy Pop song, they actually changed the lyrics in the commercial version. For example, they changed the lyric, "With liquor and drugs to looks so fine."
The result will be that the song will fall out of favor in all the other places where it could have been used, whether straightforward radio play or another use in advertising, and in so doing, the song's life is shortened and made less profitable. To illustrate further, approving the use of a song written by a writer who champions the causes of the blue-collar working man in an advertisement for a pro-business political party would not be a shrewd move on the part of the music publisher or the songwriter who might have a say in such usage. The songwriter's fans will be alienated, possibly leading to a smaller market for the songwriter's future works. The music publisher must always weigh the proposed use with the benefit to be gained, but must also keep in mind the context that could unduly prejudice the song's long-term interests. But generally, beyond the obvious contentious uses such as political or religious contexts, hygiene product advertisements, beer and alcohol advertisements, and X-rated films, the music publisher should always aim to approve the usage.
Well, you might be thinking, these sound like decisions I can make for myself. Where to use my music, who to license it to, so why should I hire a music lawyer? Well, we'll hear more from Mark Quayle later about his reasoning why it's essential to use music lawyers, but For now, let's listen to the first story I've got from Bob Donnelly about a band you might have heard of that definitely benefited from using a music lawyer. Mr. Donnelly helped this band to get off to their big break.